أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والسماء والطارق وما أدراك ما الطارق النجم الثاقب إن كل نفس لما عليها حافظ فلينظر الإنسان مما خلق خلق من ماء دافق يخرج من بين الصلب والترائب إنه على رجعه لقادر يوم تبلى السرائر فما له من قوة ولا ناصر والسماء ذات الرجع والأرض ذات الصدع إنه لقول فصل وما هو بالهزل إنهم يكيدون كيدا وأكيد كيدا فمهل الكافرين أمهلهم رويدا. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وحده وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless his entire household as well and all his companions. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every single one of us. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is tremendous, tremendous. It is amazing how every one of us is loved dearly by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But sometimes we become a little bit sad. We become saddened. We become people who are despondent without realizing that Allah loves us. He knows why He does to us, what He does to us, more than we would ever understand. And it is out of His love that He does it, come what may. We have uttered the Shahada. We have declared there is none worthy of worship besides Allah. We try our best to worship Allah alone without displeasing Him. Wherever we have faltered, we try our best to turn back as soon as possible. It hurts us where we have transgressed against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any one of us, whenever we've done something wrong, we feel within our hearts at some stage that, you know, what I did was wrong. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. A person who's committed adultery, a person who might have engaged in some form of wrong in the past, and as soon as they've done the wrong, the iman within them will make them think for a moment, what I did was wrong, and I should not be doing it. The same applies to those who might be weak in terms of obeying Allah's instructions, which have nothing to do with worshipping those besides Allah. But it has to do with an instruction to me and you that sometimes we have not yet fulfilled in a manner that we would or we are required to fulfill. Take a look at the dress code. We can always improve, men and women included, myself included. We can improve on our dress code for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know the requirement of the Sharia. Sometimes we happen to be a little bit weak in that regard. But we know deep down that I need to do better than what I am doing. And when we say dress code, for your information, in Islam, the dress that is spoken about is not only clothing that you wear, but even your character and conduct is part of your clothing. It makes you up as a person. A person who's wearing some clothing that might not even look so expensive, for example, if their character is immaculate, brilliant, very good, exemplary, they are beautiful all the time. They are very, very good looking. Their company is warm. People will not be bothered, what are you wearing? They say, wow, I met this brother and, you know, mashallah, I felt so good. They're not going to say, you know, he wore this and he wore that, unless they are cheap. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. So the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us makes us feel when we have committed a sin that we've done something wrong. And the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us feel when we've done something right and correct. And when we've worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that what I've done here is really only from the favor of Allah upon me, I'm so happy. Take a look at a person who gets up for Salatul Tahajjud. And we've always said, try that out, my brothers and sisters. Even if it means once. Just a one-off. That's a start. You will find yourselves once a month, then once a week, then mashallah twice a week. And then you will fall in love with it so much that it becomes a habit. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. So, when we get up for tahajjud, or even if we just get up for Salatul Fajr and we fulfill it properly, bearing in mind I'm doing this solely for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, immediately we begin to feel the coolness, the calmness within ourselves. I tell myself, Ya Allah, I'm getting up solely for your sake. It's just for you. Had it not been for you, Ya Allah, I would be sleeping. I would be asleep until whatever time. But it's your instruction, Ya Allah, I'm getting up, you're watching me. Ya Allah, be pleased with me. Be happy with me. I'm trying my best, Ya Allah. Every one of us should be feeling the same. And then when we fulfilled our Salatul Fajr, tell me how the day goes. You feel so good, mashallah. If you miss the salah, how do you feel? You really feel like, oh no, I missed the salah. I really shouldn't have done that. I need to fulfill it. Obviously, the hadith says, "Man nama an salatin aw nasiyaha, falyusalliha idha dhakaraha." Whoever sleeps over a salah, you know, they did not plan to sleep over it, but they slept over it, meaning they missed it because of sleep, or sheer forgetfulness out of human nature, the hadith says they should fulfill it as soon as they remember. So say for example, I set my clock. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who can really get up when that clock beeps. Sometimes people, the clock keeps on going and they just keep on snoring. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. May Allah protect us. And so sometimes we hit that clock and next thing we know the sun is already up and everything is missed. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those whom we set the clock. Soon as it rings, we sit up. You sit up and you can turn it off. Don't go back to bed. Solely for the sake of Allah. Try it. Wallahi, it works. Don't go. And say, Ya Allah, just for your sake. This sleep, I'm forsaking. Because Allah describes those whom He loves. And the believers in Surah As-Sajdah. And He says, one of the qualities of those who are going to get Jannah. And those whom we've prepared very good provisions in paradise for. تَتَجَافَى جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَضَاجِعِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ Their sides forsake their beddings, getting up at night for the sake of Allah, calling out to Him with hope and fear, and they spend from what Allah has given them. So two qualities are mentioned here. One is those who get up at night to read salah. Brothers and sisters, minimum is Salatul Fajr. This would be even more than that. But the minimum, Salatul Fajr. And those who spend, why is spending mentioned here? Let me tell you. We contaminate our hearts with the love of what Allah has created. And when we do that, the love of the Creator diminishes. The more we love materialistic items, the less the capacity is to love the Creator of all that. So this is why when we have wealth, we thank Allah. We work hard to earn a little bit. When we've earned it, mashallah, we will spend it in a halal way. Allah says, that's how you earn my pleasure. Imagine. Have you ever thought that worship in Islam is not just your relation with Allah? But Allah says, to worship me, you need to be good to your fellow human beings. Part of worshipping of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if a person loves the wealth to the degree that they hold on to it and everything becomes, you know, all about money. And sometimes this overtakes, you know, people who are very materialistic and without them realizing I've become materialistic. You know, when we go through economic hardship, then as we are coming out of it, we become so materialistic that in figures wise, we're probably earning more than we ever were. But in stinginess, we've become the most that we ever were before. May Allah protect us. It happens. So to spend from that which Allah has given you in terms of zakah, and also some voluntary wealth that we might be giving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you find someone in desperate need and you've spent a little bit and you've given out, bearing in mind, Ya Allah, you're going to give me. You know, Allah says, when you give, I will give you. Subhanallah. أنفق يا ابن آدم ينفق عليك. O son of Adam, spend. Allah will spend on you. Subhanallah.
It will be spent upon you. You give, Allah will give you more. But the thing is, it has to be with yaqeen, with conviction. Without conviction, you're thinking, hey, should I give, shouldn't I give? Okay, let me just try this thing out if it works, and then we give. Allah says, you give, Allah will give. And do not be a person who wants to give absolutely everything. Like Allah says,
وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ عُنُقِكَ وَلَا تَبْسُطُهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطِ فَتَقْعُدَ مَلُومًا مَحْسُورًا.
Do not keep your hand on your neck in such a way that you do not spend. Meaning, don't hold back so badly that you are known as stingy and your quality of stinginess is now becoming clear. And don't spend so much that you now sit regretting, hey, I had a lot, all of it I gave. But be a balanced person. You must know, okay, I'm going to give for the sake of Allah, here it is. That is through the love of Allah. Allah loves us and He puts it in our hearts to reach out to those in need. So this is why it's important for us, and I know every one of us, there is a certain chord within us that if that chord were struck, it would definitely sound the horn of spending now. For example, some people might see a destitute person and they might say, no, this person looks okay, carry on. Then they see someone without a hand. They say, okay, this person's okay. Then they carry on. Then they see a certain thing. Allah's kept it such that these receivers, you know, your eyes receive the images, your ears receive the sound and everything. And so on. When you see and when you felt and when you've heard, and now there comes a stage where there's someone that is so desperately in need and you know, whoa, this level here is quite bad. It strikes a chord. And when that is struck, automatically you think, hey, let me reach out, even if it means a few dollars. So each one of us, we cannot say we will never ever spend. None of us are such. I think it's a human nature that's given to us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the point I want to raise is, let that chord be struck sooner than later. Which means sometimes, and this is something that really we are all caught in between, where people come to beg. It happens to me as well. We are all part of the same community. People come to beg. And in our society, it's a little bit more than what people would face in developed countries. So people come to beg. And you wonder to yourself, is this person legitimate or not? That's a question I'm sure you always ask yourself. And inside, you know, I can give them. But I don't want to encourage a bad habit. It happens to all of us, I'm sure. So now they come and push the bell and they tell you, sadaqa. I'm sure you might have heard that. They tell you, give me something. You know, Eid time, they tell you, Eid Mubarak. And what that means is, are you giving me something? Now, in your heart, definitely, you feel like reaching out. But at the same time, you have a feeling inside to say, look, am I going to be encouraging behavior that is not befitting a Muslim unless he is in need? Because begging is something that's detested unless a person really has to. So what should we do? So the fact that you've thought about it is a sign of the love of Allah upon you. Allah loves you. That's why you thought. If subhanallah, we are distanced from the love of Allah, we wouldn't even bat an eyelid. Not at all. And this is why, be careful. Because the Quran says, وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرُ. And as for the one who is asking, as for the beggar, do not rebuke him. You know what is rebuke? To belittle. To make them feel like they are cheap. To tell them a word of pessimism, a dirty word, a word of disrespect, a word that will hurt their hearts, that's rebuking. The Quran says, Surah Al-Duha, we know it all off by heart. I'm sure all of us know it off by heart. وَالْضُحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. This is towards the end. Allah says, the one who asks, don't rebuke him. If you need to send him away because, for example, your analysis was that this person here may not be that legit, and you have to send him away, tell him a good word, because a good word is for free. Good word. To say, you know what, inshallah, please can you go and try to work hard or something. Say, look, I won't be able to give you something this time. Perhaps, you know, make dua. I will make dua for you and so on. By the will of Allah, you will achieve something good. Some good word. But I can tell you, what's not a bad idea is to send the man or the sister, the brother or sister, a sandwich with a little bit of water or something to eat. So you have neither said no, nor have you actually spoiled them, but you've given them something to eat. And if they were to tell you, no, I need money, in that particular case, you know that their need is not as it should be. So we don't start shouting and screaming and sometimes swearing. No, don't do that. Not at all. Part of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is when you respect those whom He sent to your door. Remember one thing. Every person who pushes your bell and who comes to your door to knock it is sent, planned by Allah. Without a doubt. It's a plan. The plan of Allah. Why? It's a test for you. How do you react? And Allah says, you don't have to give each one. Remember that. But how do you respond? That's the test. Sometimes you can get paradise just because you responded so well to a person who was desperately in need that they made a little dua for you. And they were desperately in need and their dua was accepted and suddenly you started seeing goodness and you know, in your life, doors started opening. That's because you served one of the worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with respect. Same applies to our shops and whatever businesses we have, those who work for us, everyone else we interact with. Remember, respect is the term. We want respect, we respect others. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts it in our heart to give. Give a little bit, give something. Sometimes you can give a dollar. And sometimes if you feel that, you know, this person is not going to, or this person's come back the 10th time, because it happens, then perhaps you might want to change what you're going to give them, or maybe come out and have a little chat with them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness. We do have this issue that is very live in our society, and especially if you're living in these suburbs here, it is a bit of an issue whereby lots of beggars coming to the doors, and lots of them asking for little handouts, and you know, subhanallah, it's just Allah who knows exactly the condition of that particular person. For your information, you know that to find a job is not so easy. But sometimes people earn so much through begging that they don't want to work. Because if they go to 60 houses a day, or maybe 100 houses a day, and they were to get a dollar from only 20 of them, they're earning big bucks. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, really. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. And this is why sometimes it's good for us to go out to talk to them, perhaps to give them something else. You know, a piece of clothing, something that might be of use to them. May Allah forgive us. So getting back to the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the love. When you have spent in His path and you feel good, it's a sign of the love of Allah for you. We love Allah. We all say we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But sometimes we don't realize and understand the meaning of that term, loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are weak. We are insan. But Allah knows He loves us. That's why we have uttered the shahada. That's why we do good deeds. And that's why we feel good when we do good and we feel bad when we do bad. May Allah forgive us. And this is why one of the prime things that we need to understand, and I started this talk with it, is Allah knows best why He did to you what He did to you. Remember, it's out of His love. He did it. No matter how negative it may seem, it is positive in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes we ask for something. Allah does not grant it to us. Wallahi, He knows deep down, my worshipper, just be happy with my portion for you. Just be happy with what I have decided for you. For you is paradise. If you really want what you are asking for, and if you really want me to give it to you, you may regret heavily. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the coolness of our eyes and hearts for that which He may not have given us. Although we are calling out to Him so much, whereas He knows that it's not good for us. And there are so many examples of this. You know, you have people who cry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for certain things, and Allah keeps them in one condition because Allah knows this is your best condition. Let's take a look at some who might be struggling to pay a fee, struggling sometimes to do something or financially. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. But we work hard, we call out to Allah, we are on the musalla. Some people have a health matter, some people, for example, have any other issue. Whatever your issue is, we all have different issues, and we have to have issues. Not one of us can say, I don't have an issue in my life. Not even one. Each one's issue is tailor-made. And it's for you. It's yours. This is your test. You pass it, for you is paradise. Major, big test. You fail it, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. We are in search of His mercy. So this is why we say a big test, like a person cannot pay fees or sometimes financially they are struggling. And Allah has kept them like that for 10, 15 years. And Allah knows deep down that this person is calling out to me. This person, let's say a medical problem, this person calling out to me. Oh, I love the way they call out to me. Subhanallah, what a great act of worship. You know, we're reading extra salah, we're calling out, we're crying, we're making tawbah, we're asking Allah to forgive us. We've become conscious of our deeds. Ya Allah, I better do this, I better do that. I hope you're not upset with me, Ya Allah, this, Ya Allah, I beg you. And He keeps you begging because He's kept us on par. Sometimes the minute He gives it to us, what happened to your tahajjud? Well, I used to make it the time I needed something. That's what happens. What happened to those long du'as and salah? You were in sujood crying to Allah. Where did the tears go? One tear is better than the entire dunya and what it holds. If that tear is for the pleasure of Allah, the sake of Allah, you're crying because you want something from Allah and you're calling out only to Him, it means an ibadah and an act of worship made you cry. That's better than the whole world and what it has for you. And yet, subhanAllah, as soon as we got it, where are the tears? Well, you know what? I cried, but Allah gave me. So now what? You're not crying anymore? SubhanAllah. Well, one might say, well, there's no need to. The truth is, find an act of worship that will make you cry. Find an act of worship that will really open your doors of understanding and make you weep because of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This dunya, this world is coming to an end. And before it comes to an end, most probably we will come to an end. Subhanallah. And you know, we sit healthy. A few years down the line, we're going to be old people if Allah gives us life. And after that, there is no option but to look forward to the meeting with Allah. We have to get down. We have to. You know, when I was young, very young, first time I ever went to the Luna Park, and I can share with you an experience. And you know, I was convinced, let's get onto the roller coaster. Now we used to go on this little danglers and whatever else there was, you know, small swings, we were little kids. And then someone convinced me, I can't remember who it was, let's get onto this roller coaster. And you know, you're watching it from a distance and you don't realize what you're getting yourself into. Anyway, we're in. I remember clearly they tucked us in, they closed us with a bar, and the thing started. When it started, we're just looking at each other, we're moving slow. Suddenly, something happens to you and you think, what am I doing here? Where am I? Like you're about to be flung off, and next thing it carries on, and it goes on, and you're like, your eyes are closed, and you don't know what's happening, and next thing you go to, it slows down again. And a little while later, it comes back, and you think again, what am I doing? Where am I? And you've gone on that ride. It's a roller coaster ride. And it just goes. And there's nothing you can do to stop it. I remember clearly, I was looking at a man in a green overalls who was near the buttons that were being pressed. And I was telling him, hey, stop it. And he's laughing at me. He's laughing at me. And I was a little kid. The lesson I learned from that is in life, things happen. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed you in a position where something's definitely going to happen to you. You cannot turn it away. But you need to understand it's in the hands of Allah. Leave it. It's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The same applies to death. When it comes, don't worry. You're going to go through it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. You have to. Just like when you were born. One wonders. No one says it's very hard to become born. Why? Because after that you have life. But who knows? That life, you know, we just started breathing. Suddenly there's someone. So just like that, you just stop breathing. Suddenly there'll be no one. Allahu Akbar. May Allah make it that easy for us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all a good day. But the truth is, when we start looking forward to the meeting with Allah, we don't mind. We say, Ya Allah, you take us. Whenever whenever you know it's best for us, continue. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, Allahumma ahini. Oh Allah, grant me life. For as long as you know, life is good for me. And oh Allah, take me away when you know it's better for me. That's the best dua to make. Because you want to die in a good condition, better for you. That's such a powerful dua, because then Allah protects you from dying in a condition that's not good. So He knows this is better for you to die in a condition that's good for you. And then you die in sujood. A few days ago, there was a man from Egypt who passed away in Mecca in the Haram. And he just gone into sujood and he never came up. And he was a young boy, to be honest with you. He was in his 20s. And he went down in sajda and he did not come back up. And the whole crowd, you know, were thinking, SubhanAllah, what a beautiful death and so on. And do you know what happens to some of these bodies? Some of these bodies, they happen to freeze in that condition where you cannot bring them back out into, you know, the sleeping position. Wallahi, that's something. Imagine you have to be buried in that condition. Because if the body is not relaxed, for example, and it's perhaps, I don't know what the exact word is, but the position of it is stuck, so to speak. In that particular case, what happens? They have no option. You have to be buried that way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a good day, really. And so my brothers, we were talking of the love of Allah. And now what I'm saying is, when we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in return, we understand His plan. And we're no longer, you know, depressed when we think of dying. We actually look forward to the meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we realize it's Allah who's in control. Amazing. This is the love of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps us in condition, subhanallah, subhanallah, so that we keep on calling out to Him. And this is why nobody's life is absolutely perfect. You know, if you take a careful look at wealth, wealth is said in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be a very big test. Very big test. Why is it a test? It's a test for those who have it and those who don't have it. And this test differs. Sometimes people who don't have it start questioning to the degree that they lose their iman. Sometimes it brings them closer to Allah. And sometimes those who have it, it brings them closer to Allah. And sometimes those who have it distances them. Because in a lot of cases, wealth brings about this feeling within man that now I'm someone. Allahu Akbar. It's just sad. It happens to a lot of people. But a mu'min doesn't happen to them. It doesn't happen to them. Why? Because you know, this is from Allah. He can take it. He can do anything right here, right now. There were days when I did not have it. And this is why if you take a careful look at generations, as time passes, there are people who've made their money in 10 years, some in 5 years, some in 40 years, some they're still, you know, busy trying and so on. But to be honest, the previous generation, I'm talking of the bulk of us, the previous generation and the previous one were perhaps much poorer than we are. But guess what? They complained less. They complained less. I know of people who sold vegetables. And later on, perhaps their families became tycoons, wealthy. But today you find there is more lack of contentment in us who have a little bit more than those previously who had absolutely none. They were barefoot, walking. They used to send their shoes. Listen to this, and I'm going to say this because it really means something. They would send their shoes every time something happened to the shoe, to the cobbler. And they would pay whatever it was needed, a few cents, and get it back. Today, let's be honest, myself included. If your shoe has a little bit of a hole in it, there are from amongst us those who will send, you know, the shoe to the cobbler. But I think the number has decreased and diminished so much so that nothing's wrong with the shoe. But you saw another pair and you say, hey, let me buy this one. That's where we've become. But in our heart, what's the condition? Wallahi, we're not as happy as those people. Let's be honest. Why? Because we have not understood Allah's love for us. Allah gave you a pair better than everyone else before you from your own family. But now you're not happy. Because when you look at the other pair, say, I got Nike Airs. You know, these are called, I don't know, Cumulus or something. There's a top shoe. No, these are Asics. Oh, wow. This has a gel, you know. Now the other one, you know, they say it's got a bit of, I don't know, whatever else in it. And so I need that one, you know. And now you're depressed. You're sad, even with mobile phones. You know, there was a time when all our homes, I don't know if you recall, we had those phones, those old ancient phones. You open, you turn it and you hear, you know, and on the other side. And then you have to take your finger and the other way. And you can't even get through to Zambia. You need to dial an operator and book a call. And you book the call and he says, okay, I'll call you back in 1 hour. Or you say, okay, 10:30 in the evening. And I promise you, everybody's waiting around the phone. Next thing it rings, is this your number? Yes. Okay, hold on for your caller. Oh, wait, we are connecting you. And then they connect you and everyone's talking. And wow, those were the days. But people were so happy. Today, we can call, push of a button for almost free on something like Viber. And yet, there's no communication, number one. Number two is, you're not even happy to talk to the others. And everything is gone. But look at communication technologies. Why? We haven't looked at how much Allah loves us. That He's given us technology far beyond what our forefathers would have ever imagined in their lives. Imagine if they had it. Allahu Akbar. One wonders. But still, where are we? The heart has changed. Why does the heart change? The heart changes because you do not recognize that Allah loves you. That's why. So I started off by saying Allah loves you, definitely, and me, and all of us. He definitely loves us. But a winner is the one who recognizes that love of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then does something about it. So in order to recognize the love of Allah, you need to think, you need to ponder. You know, in marriages sometimes, and I'm just going to give you this example, because it's also happening. Sometimes you find, you know, the man is working hard and so on, and you know, he, mashallah, he tries his best, and he earns, and he brings back a little bit at home, and you know, sometimes you just hear complaints. You just hear, no, you've done nothing. You know, we can do better. No, but the man is struggling. He's trying his best. And so on. But when she sits and she starts thinking, hey, this man goes out in the morning, he comes back in the evening, he carries on. Okay, he might have a few weaknesses. We are human beings. That's part of the test. But he tries so hard, so hard. Automatically, the love builds in her heart. Why? That man is living and really he's serving me. He's really trying his best. He brings back, he tries. You know, he comes home, he smiles. I hope we do. He comes home, he tries his best, inshallah. You know, he says a good word or two. And here I am, I'm just saying words that are just cutting all the time. Cutting, cutting. Why? I haven't understood his love. And then she says, but you don't ever tell me you love me. I need you to say, well, you know what, to be honest with you, she just needs a torch. They call it an ultraviolet torch, and you write it with an ultraviolet pen on your forehead here. Whenever you want to see, just shine the torch on my forehead, you'll see it's written there. Allahu Akbar. It's there. Ultraviolet. May Allah safeguard us. You don't need... Okay, it's important to say, and I know with the new generations, you need to say about 24 times a day, I think. With the new generation, it's increasing. Before, you know, in my generation, we still 5-6 would get away with it. You know, 5-6 times a day. And you guys, you need to say it much more. Whoa. You need to look in the eyes. I love you. Whoa. Okay, thanks. Thanks. Even if you didn't go to work that day, didn't bring back any money. I love you. Don't worry. Never mind. I understand. Why? But if you were to think without those words, just think, what sacrifice they've made for you. Come on. They've sacrificed day and night. They've actually gone out. They've worked hard. They might have to have go here, go there. And we're busy complaining. I haven't seen you and this. You know, you don't love me. You don't spend time with me. My brothers, it's important to spend time. We're not saying, we're not trying to justify the wrongdoings of the brothers. But what we are saying is, wherever there is dedicated sacrifice, it will only blossom when the other party sits and ponders over the sacrifice. The same applies to the females. A man will not understand the sacrifice of his wife until he knows what pain she's gone through to deliver, for example. Until he knows, for example, sitting and thinking how she's got the house in order. Everything is clean. Even if you've got a maid or whatever else, helping hands at home. But everything is clean, smart. They're waiting for you. They're trying with the children. They've taught the children so much. You know, they get them ready. They do this. You need to sit and think. Without thinking of it, you won't appreciate the love of that individual for you. So even if they love you, the other side is doesn't understand the love. That's what happens between us and Allah. He loves us, but we haven't yet sat and thought. Everything He's given us, we just ponder over one or two little things, and after that, you know what, we get upset. And we say, Allah hasn't given me. What hasn't He given you? And you talk about, you say about three things. I can mention 3 million things that He's given you. Come on. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. May He help us and may He really grant us increase. I want to end this session by mentioning a story that I mentioned yesterday in the masjid. The brothers, some of them may have heard it, but for the benefit of the sisters and the others, it's a very touching story. It also shows the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Never, ever underestimate the power of Allah. You know, there was a sheikh who mentioned this in Saudi Arabia, and there was a doctor that visited him from Pakistan and told him a story that happened to him. So he says, what happened to me? He says, the doctor who's speaking is a top neurologist. One of the top doctors in Pakistan, or, you know, a very, very good doctor. Very hard to meet. It's said that perhaps you would have to wait months on end before you can get an appointment to see him. So what happened is, he says, I was flying from one city to another. Very busy man, flying quite often within the country and perhaps even outside. And he says, suddenly, the clouds built up. Huge clouds, and the lightning started striking and it started pouring and there was lots of turbulence and one of the engines was struck and it was damaged. So we had to land. And so what happened is, the landing was at a nearby little airport or a little strip and so on. And when they landed there, it was a remote area. How are you going to repair this aircraft? A few people who were on it, it was a small plane, they were, quite surprised because they landed in such a remote place. No one's there to repair it. They would have to wait, definitely. So the doctor asks the captain or the pilot that, you know what, how long are you going to be? He says, no, we're going to be quite long. Well, I need to get to that area. Look, he says, it's just a 3-hour drive by vehicle. So why don't you just go by road? And you know, you can go there and get there. He says, okay, good idea, because this is going to take long. So he decides to go on one of the trishaws, you know, in Pakistan, one of the areas, wherever it was, and he jumped in. And as they started progressing, the clouds built again. And the lightning was striking, and the rain started pouring. And it was pouring so much that their vehicle could not move much more because of the mud and because of everything else. And so it was quite an open area with a bit of farmland. And after a while they realized, look, we're not getting anywhere. There's a little house here. Why don't we just go there? We can read our salah. Perhaps we can, you know, see, have a bit of a meal or whatever else. And they decided to knock the door. Strange people, strange land, far off, out in the rurals. And so he knocks the door and he's got his little bag and everything and he walks in. An old lady happened to answer the door after a while and they spoke to her saying, look, this is what has happened and we're going from so and so to so and so and we just want a place, we want to read salah and so on. And she said, no problem, you can come in. She had a little musalla, a little sajjada, and she had a little baby on the side, or not a baby, but a child. And the child, every little while, she's actually checking on the child and she's sitting on that musalla making dua and reading her own salah. These people fulfilled their salah, did whatever they had to. When they were about to leave, they spoke to the old lady saying, you know, thank you very much, jazakumullah khair and so on. And, you know, we're going, what's happening to this child, you know? So the woman says, look, the child is an orphan. And the child is unwell, not well at all, very sick. And we've been to all the doctors around. We've been to all the doctors around. And subhanallah, I'm the grandmother of this child. The doctors have told us that there is only one specialist around. One specialist around who can help this child. And we tried to make an appointment, but they asked us to come 6 months later. And it's far away. I've been making dua to Allah ever since that day. Ya Allah, make it easy for us. The child is sick. The child is sick. Make it easy for us, Ya Allah. So the man says, what's the name of that specialist? So the granny says, he's Dr. Ishan. Immediately this doctor burst into tears. He burst into tears. Straight away, he burst into tears. Why are you crying? Your dua has just been accepted. For your dua, the thunder came, the lightning came, the engine struck, we came down, we came on the road, the rain came again and stopped us and so on. And do you know what? The rain only stopped after the question was asked. Now it happened. And now the woman starts crying. Subhanallah. And the doctor himself is telling the story saying, that was me. It happened to me, he says. And he says, I learned that Allah's armies are beyond limits. Allah uses whatever He wants to get what He wants done. It's over. Where in the wildest of the dreams of this person would they have felt or believed that the top man whom it is semi-impossible to see without big appointments would actually be driven all the way to the door, knock the door, come in here, read some salah, and they would have to serve the child here. Amazing. Wallahi, it brings tears to the eyes. But the reason I share it with you, every one of us has needs for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just keep calling. Just have yaqeen. Have conviction. If it is meant, it will definitely come in your direction. You know, we use the term by hook or crook, but I don't want to use that today. I want to tell you, by the mercy and power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will happen. It will come to pass. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. May He open our doors. May He grant us all shifa. And may He make us firm believers that for Him,